All right, folks, it's time for some more custom cards. And this time around, I ask you to make some cards you'd like to see added to the core set as new cards. And we saw a bunch of those yesterday, all the new cards being added to the core sets. This is a bit of an alternate reality. What if these cards were in the core set instead? Do you think that'd be better, worse? Would they open up different archetypes and lines of play? I think so. And in some cases, I like the cards here better than some of the real ones we got, even though those were pretty nifty as well. Now, as we get into it, I do want to say this video is sponsored by Skillshare, which we'll take a look at a little bit later on. But for now, let's talk about Elise the Visionary from DeSantis D. It's, of course, a 5-mana 5/5, as the last few Elises have been, or the last couple Elises. And her battle cry reads, discover a sealed standard pack and shuffle it into your deck. So really borrowing the Unguro Elise gameplay here, but making it a standard pack instead of an Unguro pack, which is really just like perfect for a core set card. And it could last the test of time as well. Like this could rotate in and out and always be something that fits in the core set and really serves as like a model for what, you know, standard format is really all about. And if you don't remember how that worked, essentially shuffles a 2-mana spell into your deck. You get that spell, it's opening the pack, and you get 5 random cards. They were a little bit biased, I believe, towards legendaries and epics compared to a normal pack. So often it would be a pretty good pack. And this would be a great mid-game value generator, just like Elise was in Unguro. I loved playing with that card, and I think I would put this in a ton of decks as well, just because it's really fun to get new different resources throughout the course of a game. And you know, every game looks a little bit different thanks to your Elise, and value decks love the extra card in deck, and of course the extra cards in hand as well when they get them. Even if on average they aren't always the highest quality, it's just a bunch of stuff bundled into a single card. So I think this would be like the perfect epitome of what a core set card should be. It's a character we know and love. It represents the format itself. It's absolutely perfect. I want this one in the game right now. Moving on here to the Faceless Influencer from Rob K, a 3-mana 3/3 for Priest, and it reads, draw a holy spell. Awesome utilization here of our new spell schools. And it reads, at the end of your turn, transform it into a random shadow spell. So hey, some shadow support as well perhaps here, but I really like the idea of this card manipulating sort of two different sides of spell schools and taking a spell and transforming. It's really fun. So basically, you could say you're on like, I don't know, 10 mana, right? Late in the game. And maybe you really need a heal from your deck. You are happy to get the holy spell off the top because it's got some kind of healing aspect, or maybe it's a holy nova and you need a board clear, and that's great. Or maybe you don't need a heal. Maybe you're 30 health, you're in a control matchup, and your Holy Nova is just not going to do anything because you're playing a control warrior. It's like, who cares? So you draw your Holy Nova, and you wait, and then it turns into a shadow spell that might actually get some sort of utility or value for you. And this gives you the ability to kind of manipulate your draws or manipulate the time you play this in order to get the resources that you might want or need from a matchup. It's also maybe risky to tempo it out on 3 if you need a Holy Nova on 4, because it's like, oh shoot, I got my Holy Nova, but now it's a random shadow spell. So there's a lot of decision making and planning and deck building that could go into a card like this, which I think is really cool. And I was surprised we didn't see more school spell support in the core set that we saw. You know, that's a permanent feature of Hearthstone now. It's a fixture in the game. So core set cards can certainly reference spell schools, and I mean there were only a couple, I think, or maybe they're all even in barons, I'm not sure, but regardless, I think that's something that the core set absolutely could thrive on, and it would really help bring some interesting designs together, and a card like this would be perfect at doing that. So moving on here to Nazdormu the Ageless, another one from Kogeti, a 9-mana 8/8 dragon, and it reads, each player can only play one card per turn. So a bit of a twist on the old original Nazdormu here. Essentially, instead of limiting your time, it limits the number of cards you can play. And of course, if Nazdormu is killed, that card text is removed and that limitation is now gone, which means, you know, much like the old Nazdormu, like you had a time limit, but as soon as you killed Nazdormu, the timer would be fine. You'd have plenty of time. And it works the same way here with this Nazdormu. But on that off chance, your first card, or you don't have a card that easily kills Nazdormu or a way on board, you might be checked on what you can do, which I think occasionally could give this a little bit of a real strategic element where like a control deck is, you know, looking to stabilize and counter pressure an aggro deck. And you know they're not going to be able to kill an 8-8 easily. So you just play Nozdormu and you know that they're like only going to hit you one time or play one card or one damage spell and you really limit what they can do. And you don't care because all your cards are 8-9 mana anyway because you're a late game deck, but all their cards are 1 mana. So you start to gain this real mana limitation advantage if they can't kill Nozdormu. Now that might be a little too oppressive in some ways, but I think it's okay. It's still just a 9 mana 8-8, so there's a lot of sacrifice. If they can answer this, you've kind of wasted your turn and haven't really done much. So an interesting design. Now, of course, the real Nozdormu we saw is all about this kind of meme blitz mode Hearthstone where if you're both running it, turns are only 15 seconds long, which that's super fun. That's great. It's not competitive at all. But I do like the way this one takes a like different twist on what Nozdormu kind of was and makes it more accessible and maybe even more competitively viable as well, which is hard to do, but I think this card does it really, really nicely. Moving on to the Clockwork Tinkerer. It's from Magic Milk. 3 mana, 2/3 here. And the battle cry reads, draw a 1-cost card, and it upgrades each turn that this is in your hand. So essentially, if over time, it would draw you a 2-cost card, a 3-cost card, or 4-cost card, etc. And eventually, maybe draw you some really big stuff. And I like the flavor of this because it kind of plays off of Gnomish Inventor and Novice Engineer, the old school staple, like, you know, neutral card draw cards. I mean, Gnomish hasn't seen much play, but Novice has seen lots and lots of play over time. And this is that same sort of flavor and feel as a, maybe she's not a gnome, but still kind of a, like a tinkerer or inventor style card that evolves it. It takes it to the next level, essentially, as a upgradable tutor style card that's drawing you very specific sorts of resources. And that's a great tool because it's like adding a lot of layered decision making and planning for when you're going to squeeze this card into a turn. Because maybe you really, really want a 4-mana card, which means you have to play this when it gets upgraded to that 4 spot, but that could like ruin a turn, spend up too much mana. Maybe you really, really want to get a 1-cost card and you have to play this immediately, or you can't because you don't have enough mana, things go wrong. So it's like this deck building challenge, this play style challenge, this timing challenge, all of which seem really rewarding strategically, but also present a lot of opportunity to do cool things. So it's like I have my deck built around Deck of Chaos, and I want to make sure that I'm drawing Deck of Chaos. And it's my only 6-mana card, so I want to get a Clockwork Tinkerer and make sure it gets to 6 cost to guarantee I draw that Deck of Chaos as soon as possible. That becomes a thing you can do with cards like this one, but you also have to wait 6 turns, which is a long time. So, you know, if Clockwork Tinkerer is in your mulligan, maybe you're okay. If it's not, that could still be a problem. So some really neat things around the design of this card. I love it. I think it's a perfect upgrade to what we have in Classic and Basic, but re-envisioned and updated for modern Hearthstone and for the core set. All right, so before we go on to our next card, let's talk about our sponsor for this video. It's Skillshare. If you don't know Skillshare, it's an online community where millions of people go to take online classes to learn various creative skills. You could learn how to draw, to paint. You could learn video editing to make your very own YouTube channel like this one. Members get access to thousands of different inspiring classes, most of which are under an hour with short lessons. For instance, I took this class, Advanced Video Editing with Adobe Premiere Pro, with Jordy Vandeput. He had a pretty nice beard and some handy tips and tricks. And special bonus, the first 1,000 people who use the link in the description will get a free trial of a Skillshare premium membership. There's a lot to learn in this world, and I'm excited to hear what you guys learn on Skillshare. All right, so now that you know how to do lots of nifty things off Skillshare, let's learn how to destroy all the duplicates in your deck here with Equalizing Spirit from Tough One. This is a 3-mana 3/4, and indeed, that's what it does. Destroys all duplicates in your deck. Now, first off, we got to talk about what that means. I'm interpreting that to mean it's destroying the duplicate version. It's not destroying both of any duplicates. It, in other words, leaves behind 1 of 2 cards. So that could be a great like Highlander enabler for decks that maybe want to run a couple duplicates just because they have really powerful cards, or maybe some early game, but then don't want to ruin their, you know, Zephyrus forever, even though we all know Zephyrus is rotating. But keep in mind, even if we're not going to get any Highlander support in the core set, you could in future iterations, and this would be a great way to enable that. Alternatively, this could be a bit of like a tech card almost to answer things like Bomb Warrior. And again, I know Bomb Warrior's rotating, but things like this can come back. It's not gone forever. And there might be other things like it in the future as well. So that if your opponent like shuffled a bunch of garbage in your deck that you didn't want, maybe it's, you know, even like Albatross Birds. Again, I know it's rotating. We're talking about, we're talking about generic examples. Any sort of negative effect in your deck, this could remove all those extra copies and essentially clean things up. So maybe a Highlander enabler, maybe you know, filter basically for garbage that your opponent puts in your deck could exist really cool in both those directions. And I would like a card like that to be available in the core set. Probably not in this particular iteration of the core set based on what we've seen. I don't know if this one would make a lot of sense right now, but in future iterations of the core set with Highlander potentially coming back, with shuffle stuff coming back, absolutely Equalizing Spirit would be really, really cool. Oh, I should also say one other neat aspect of this is that you might have a deck structure where you just have a lot of duplicates in the early game, and then you have some really high-powered, like crazy heavy-hitting legendaries in the mid to late game. This could actually help you find those legendaries at a slightly higher rate, basically removing a bunch of, you know, low-cost junk from your deck that you don't need once you get to the mid game, and increasing the likelihood that you find your mid to high-cost cards, because those are only one of. So, you know, you had 15 cards, you remove five that were duplicates essentially, and now you get five legendaries and five other cards that you remove the duplicates of. So essentially you went from like a 33% chance to hit your big awesome legendary to a 50% chance to hit your big awesome legendary. So I don't know how good that would be, but another interesting application of this card. This is like sneaky interesting in how many different things this card can do. All right, moving on here to the Shoreside Scout from Bob Tinder. It's a really, really simple card. I won't have much to say about this one, but that's good. It's just a really nice fitting building block sort of card that is exactly what the core set needs. So it's a 2-mana 2/2 Murloc, and it just is Battlecry, draw a Murloc. And that's awesome. That's the sort of filler stuff you need for archetypes to be supported. And we saw some Murlocs get rotated out. So having new Murlocs like this to come in to replace them would go a long way. And we didn't really see that so much as far as new cards are concerned. So Murlocs, you know, lost some key pieces, didn't necessarily get support in the core set. Now, maybe there will be support coming in like expansions if they want Murlocs to work. That's a possibility. But I think having a few key new elements as part of the core set could really feel good and give us more stuff to work with as we move into future expansions, because we learned not all core set cards are going to rotate, right? So a lot of them are going to stick around, and a card like this seems like a great inclusion as a Murloc tutor and just a way to keep the engine running in Murlocs. If they don't have sort of pressure or follow-up from a card like Murloc Warleader, then having something like this that keeps the hand flowing could go a long way. Now, there are some downsides to a card like this. It can tutor very specifically Murlocs or even amalgam style cards. That could be a bad thing, but maybe it could be a good thing too, right? We've seen plenty of minion type tutors as well. So a couple different directions for this one, and just a really clean, elegant design. This looks 100% like a real Hearthstone card. Moving on, who wouldn't want this card to be in the core set? It's Tarling. The artwork here is a mess, but that's okay. We get it. It's some kind of blob of tar. Comes from Drop Dead. It's a 2-mana 1/3 elemental, has taunt and plus 2 attack during your opponent's turn. So this is basically a miniature Tar Creeper or one of the Tar cards. I just realized there's a lot of like Unguro callbacks in this video. I don't know what that tells us. Maybe the Unguro meta was actually just super, super awesome and fun. But I love the idea of having a kind of aggro speed bump taunt like this available. Tar Creeper was really cool in that regard, the way it was really defensively minded, taking great trades on defense, but not being such a viable threat on offense. It still sometimes got played in aggro decks, but still the design for it is perfect. And Tarling does that really well too, as a nice 3/3 taunt you can plop down for 2 mana, slow down your opponents. And that's great. That's what I want in Hearthstone. That's what I want. Just little cards like this that help slow down those aggro pushes just a little without being like totally oppressive. You know, you could probably make this a 1/4 that gains one attack and it could still do a pretty good job, but I actually like this spot. You don't want it to be too hard to kill, but still take some good trades. And remember, it is only 2 mana here, so you can't go too nuts with the stats, or it would really start to be oppressive. So really just another clean, simple card that would be a great fit as a tool to have in the core set. So next up here, let's take a look at this version of Alexstrasza from Kogetti. We saw, of course, the real Alexstrasza revealed yesterday. She deals 8 damage to enemy characters or restores 8 health to friendly ones. This one's all about the healing instead, and it reads Battlecry set the health of both heroes to 40. So this borrows a little bit Amara, Warden of Hope, the Unguro quest for Priest, the reward there, setting your hero to 40 health, but it's symmetrical instead. That feels a bit Alexstrasza-like, since she could either go face or, go friendly. Of course, this is a positive in both aspects, but nonetheless, it's a cool one. And I was like, oh, you can't do that. That's the quest reward. That's like too good of a result for a card that you can just run in your deck without having to build your deck around or putting all that work into. But then I also thought, like, well, Nozari came along, and Nozari wasn't a good card. Nozari full healed to 30. That wasn't great. 40 is notably better, of course. It's just a bigger heal. It gives you more time. I think the 8-8 body on Alexstrasza here would also be better. And, of course, it's better against combo decks in particular. Getting higher thresholds of health can really help stomp out any kind of OTK that needs certain health thresholds. So this could exist as an answer to OTK decks. It could just be that big late-game bomb heal that you need. It could be that randomly generated card that completely changes what games look like on occasion. And in fact, I was thinking, like, man, maybe you could even, like, push this to, like, 50 or something. Just making it, like, the ultimate heal card. I don't know if that's just, like, my control deck fantasies thriving or if that's a reality. What do you think? Could this go to, like, 45, 50 health? Would that be reasonable at 9 mana? It is symmetrical, remember, so maybe. I want to hear your thoughts. Like, I would almost push this card a little bit harder. I'm not sure it's unique enough or different enough at 40. I still like it. I still think it's cool, but I want to go to 50 health. Let's do it. And then finally here we have Patchwork from Sabassi. It's an 8-mana 2/8 and certainly borrows from the Battlegrounds character. And again, we got another 40 health card, because at the start of the game, if this is the only neutral card in your deck, you start the game with 40 health instead of 30, which is really cool. Like, that would be a fun way to really slow down aggro for me personally. Maybe would be a little bit too oppressive in the meta, because aggro decks might have a really hard time dealing 40 health. But there is a nice limitation here that you can't have any neutral cards in your deck. So basically taking a pure paladin and moving it into neutral and moving it into the core set if this were to exist. And what that would do for decks, like, man, it might actually be hard sometimes to build a good deck without any neutral cards. Pure Paladin can do it because they have a ton of support for it. But if there's no other support cards and other classes, like, can Priest do that reliably? Do they need neutral card legendaries or threats or taunts? Perhaps and perhaps not. That's what would make a card like this really cool, is figuring that out. And the cool thing about the core set is that you can design into these sorts of things because you know what you're working with and it's a limited set of cards. So you can print really powerful neutral cards, and then a card like Patchwork kind of balances that out. It's like, man, I really want to run these high-powered cards, but I also want to run Patchwork. And they start to work against each other. And with the core set, you can manipulate how those are balanced. It's harder to do when you're working with this giant classic and basic set, but when you have a very finite set of cards and you know you can control that system, cards like Patchwork become more possible. Now, I don't know if this one's a perfect example, right? But I think it's a good example of how core sets can really open up design and change how things look, because that's exactly what Patchwork would require to be a fair card. And there you go, folks. That's it for this custom card review. Be sure to check out that sponsor, Skillshare. It's a really, really awesome site. You can learn a lot there. So hit the link in the description for that. But in the meantime, share your thoughts on these cards. Man, what do you think about all of these? Do you love Elise the Visionary as much as me? You think we don't need that sort of thing? What other kind of cards would you like to see? Which of these are broken? They're not strong enough? I want to hear all your thoughts in the comments below. But until then, of course, thanks much for watching. And until next time, game on.